The terms weathering and erosion are often used synonymously, but they're not at all the same thing. In this video, I'm going to go over the difference between erosion and weathering. And we'll start by talking about weathering, the difference between chemical and physical weathering, specifically how chemical weathering dissolves minerals, how that works, the process behind that, how weathering affects global climate, and how biology, how life can facilitate both physical and chemical weathering. Then we'll talk about erosion, which can occur by water, wind, gravity, and glaciers, which I guess also counts as water. So, first things first, weathering and erosion work together to shape the kind of morphology, the, shapes and structures of Earth's surface. And by the end of this video, you'll be able to answer the question of whether this rock arc in this picture was caused by erosion or weathering, or both. Both is an option. Weathering is the physical and chemical breakdown and alteration of rocks and minerals at or near Earth's surface. We have to specify at or near Earth's surface because when we're talking about alteration of rocks and minerals at depth within Earth's crust or mantle, that either becomes igneous or metamorphic processes. So, at or near Earth's surface, when rocks are altered typically by more low temperature processes, this is weathering. Whereas erosion is the transportation and removal of that weathered material. So basically, weathering prepares material for erosion. But there's so much more to weathering than just the physical and chemical breakdown of rocks and minerals at Earth's surface. There are two major types, physical and chemical, and I want to talk a little bit about both of these types because it turns out they're like super interesting in terms of what causes them and how the weathering kind of progresses. So first off, physical weathering. Physical weathering is the breakdown of rocks and minerals into smaller pieces without a change in composition. We kind of have to specify without changing chemical composition because if the chemical composition changes, then it was chemical weathering. Some examples of physical weathering include frost wedging, when water seeps into cracks in rocks and freezes and expands when it freezes, and that forces the rock to fracture. And there's also thermal expansion and contraction. Daily temperature changes cause rocks to expand and contract, which weakens and fractures the rock. Often, this is also caused by water within the rock, and that expands and contracts with temperature changes, and that causes, weakness and fractures and weathering. Keep in mind, these examples are still physical weathering rather than erosion because the material that is weathered off of the rock is not being transported anywhere yet. Once it's transported and removed from that area, that is then erosion. Moving to chemical weathering now, this refers to the chemical alteration of rocks and minerals. And as a geochemist myself, I find this topic to be most interesting with regards to weathering and erosion. Some examples of chemical weathering include hydrolysis, in which minerals react with water and either dissolve or transform into something else. And a really important example of this is with feldspar, which transforms into clay upon hydrolysis. I'll talk more about this process later in the video when I get to kind of weathering in soil environments, because that process turns out to be like super important. Another example of chemical weathering is oxidation. Minerals react with air, oxygen in the atmosphere, and that alters their chemical composition in some way. For example, iron-rich minerals like pyrite, which contains what's called reduced iron or ferrous iron that has kind of extra electrons to give up, that reacts with oxygen because oxygen loves to take other things' electrons. And this process in which oxygen reacts with the iron and pyrite and takes away its electrons is called oxidation. The oxygen is oxidizing the iron, and the iron is reducing the oxygen. This oxidation process, especially with regards to iron minerals, is also called rusting. And this happens anytime iron-containing rocks are exposed to air for a long enough time, especially if they're exposed to air and water. And the last example I'll mention for chemical weathering is carbonation, in which atmospheric carbon dioxide reacts with water to form carbonic acid, which then goes on to dissolve certain minerals in soils, in limestone deposits, forming caves, forming sinkholes. Basically, it can dissolve many minerals depending on how concentrated it is and how long the exposure is and what sediment it's infiltrating into. And this isn't the only acid out there that causes chemical weathering. There are many acids that form in the atmosphere and rain out as acid rain, which cause chemical weathering. Sulfuric acid, nitric acid, carbonic acid, all of these things can form in different relative amounts and cause chemical weathering, but carbonic acid is a very common one. So when we think about chemical weathering on Earth's surface, where most of Earth's crust, 90% of the crust is silicate minerals, in other words, minerals containing silica or silicon dioxide, potentially the most important reaction to consider, like I mentioned earlier, is feldspar hydrolysis. Feldspar is a sodium, potassium, and/or calcium aluminum silicate mineral, and it can undergo incongruent dissolution in which certain ions like calcium, magnesium, potassium, and sodium can dissolve out of the mineral first or more easily, leaving behind variable amounts of aluminum and silica, which can also dissolve but aren't as easily dissolved. And so typically, this incongruent dissolution of feldspars leaves behind metal oxides like aluminum oxide phases and aluminosilicates, in other words, clay minerals. This is what actually leads to soil formation. I have a video, oh gosh, I can't even remember which video it is anymore. I think it's my clay video or my really old soil video, but I talk about how soil is a mixture of clay, silt, and sand. Now, these are just grain sizes. Clay is the smallest grain size, silt is in between clay and sand is a little bit bigger than both. But in general, soils contain a mixture of these three components, as well as, of course, organic matter, water, and other things. But in terms of sediment, they contain clay, silt, and sand. And a lot of that clay comes from this feldspar reaction that leaves behind these oxides and aluminosilicate clay minerals. Now, I will get back to soil in a second, but before I move on from silicate weathering, I do want to mention how silicate weathering greatly affects climate. The reason is because when silicates are chemically weathered, in other words, incongruently dissolved, some of the ions, like calcium ions, are transported to the ocean where they can react with bicarbonate ions, which are typically available in abundance, to form calcium carbonate minerals. So, in other words, silicate weathering enhances carbon burial rates in the form of calcium carbonate, which contains carbon, and leads to a long-term storage of carbon in calcium carbonate-containing rocks. In other words, calcite or limestone rocks. This is a negative climate feedback loop, in other words, a balancing climate feedback loop, because increasing CO2 can cause warming, which causes more weathering because there's more rain and more acid rain because more CO2 in the atmosphere reacts with water to form carbonic acid, leading to more chemical weathering of silicates, which leads to more calcium influx to the ocean. And of course, the acid rain leads to more carbonic acid and bicarbonate ions transport to the ocean, and this leads to the calcium carbonate formation and carbon burial in the form of calcium carbonate. And carbon burial leads to cooling because it takes that carbon from the atmosphere and stores it in the rocks, reducing greenhouse gas concentrations and cooling the Earth over, of course, thousands to millions of years, but it does eventually lead to gradual cooling effect, and that balances out the warming effect during periods of increased CO2 and other greenhouse gases. Now, keep in mind, though, that this is one climate feedback that I'm mentioning here that's operating on Earth. There are so many different feedback mechanisms. Some are positive. They exacerbate the current trend, whether it be cooling or warming. Some are negative feedbacks, like this one, that balance out the current trend, and they all operate on different time scales and different spatial scales. And it's just a very complex thing to understand all of the things that affect global climate. So please understand this loop is not quite that simple, but in terms of isolating this one effect, that is kind of the feedback loop that we would get. Now, I want to talk about biological weathering, in which life, organisms, can facilitate both physical and chemical weathering. The organisms that do this are often the ones that colonize mineral surfaces to gain nutrients, such as bacteria, algae, fungi, and lichens. And this causes both physical and chemical weathering because they physically penetrate the rock and they chemically dissolve the rock. But how exactly do they do that? Well, first, let's talk about physical biological weathering. An example of this is plant roots. Plant roots are a big source of physical weathering in newly forming soils, as well as established soils, and fungi hyphae, which are kind of similar to plant roots, but they're from fungi and often kind of micro-sized instead of macro-sized. And these both can penetrate cracks and grain boundaries within rocks, physically breaking them down. And actually, a lot of you know that much of what I talk about on my channel is Earth history, kind of events that have happened in Earth's past. And one of the events that really heavily affected Earth's climate and evolution moving forward was the evolution of land plants with roots, because roots started to break down the kind of plain rock that made up the land at the time to finally form like well-established soils. And this really affected weathering rates and influx of ions to the ocean, which heavily affected both climate and biological evolution. So this is just a really important process, not only today for forming soils and for increasing weathering rates, but also throughout Earth's history. Another type of physical biological weathering is burrowing organisms, burrowing animals, burrowing microbes. These can, for obvious reasons, physically break down the rocks. But there are also microorganisms that can physically weather rocks by covering them in what's called EPS, or extracellular polymeric substances that some microbes can excrete from their cells. It's kind of this mucusy substance that they can excrete to create microenvironments where they can kind of store nutrients and stuff for their whole colony or community of microbial cells. And this EPS retains water, promoting mineral fracturing and dissolution of the minerals. So this is kind of physical to begin with, but once it promotes the dissolution, then it becomes chemical biological weathering. Speaking of, chemical biological weathering can occur a little bit more directly too, because bacteria and fungi often actively produce organic acids to dissolve rocks in order to gain nutrients, certain ions from the rocks. Many of these acids are metabolic byproducts from the bacteria or fungi, meaning that they metabolize in some way. Our metabolism is taking up oxygen and eating organic matter, which contains things like glucose, and then we oxidize the glucose all the way to CO2. And throughout this process, it creates ATP, which is like our energy. In any case, one of our metabolic byproducts is CO2. And sure, microbes often also respire oxygen the same way we do, but microbes also have many other metabolic byproducts because there are so many different metabolisms of microbes. Not all microbes take up oxygen or even need oxygen at all. They can take up other compounds and produce other things. And sometimes their metabolic byproducts can produce acids that dissolve rocks. But sometimes, instead of being metabolic byproducts, they can even actively excrete organic acids when nutrients are limited. So they're actively stimulated in some way to produce these acids when they need more nutrients. And when they have rocks around them, rocks contain ions that are great nutrients. So they dissolve the rocks and can transport those ions into their cells. And the last kind of biological weathering I want to discuss is organic matter degradation in soils. So we've kind of talked about how silicate minerals like feldspars can react with water in soils and eventually form clay phases. We've also talked about how biology, life, can facilitate such dissolution of rocks, but they also can degrade the organic material rather than just the inorganic material within soils. Most organic matter, like plant debris or other microbial debris, whatever it may be, most of that dead organic matter that gets, buried into the soil is degraded really quickly by bacteria and fungi within the soil. And this process just refers to the uptake of the organic carbon by the microbes and fungi, and they can typically convert it all the way to CO2 or at least some other more oxidized carbon product, either by fermentation or respiration. And some of this CO2 goes to the atmosphere, but some reacts with water to form carbonic acid, which then goes on to further dissolve minerals like feldspar, creating more clay phases, etc. But complex organic materials like lignin, resin, and waxes remain intact for up to thousands of years. So there are some organic materials within the soil that are not easily degraded by the bacteria and fungi, and that's why soils remain organic matter rich. Also, the production of organic matter continues while bacteria and fungi are breaking it down. So that's another reason why soils remain organic matter rich. Typically, the more stubborn organic materials that aren't broken down easily by bacteria and fungi are called humic substances, which includes three major categories: fulvic acid, which is the lightest in color and least stubborn, so it is stubborn but not quite as stubborn as the other two categories, like humic acid, and humin, which is really dark in color and is the most stubborn in terms of how hard it is to break down. That's actually why we call the topmost part of soil the humus, just referring to humic substances, because that's what's left over after bacteria and fungi degrade the other organic materials, is just the humus layer. Now, finally, moving on to erosion. Erosion, like I mentioned, is the transport and removal of weathered materials. Typically, this is caused by water, wind, glaciers, or gravity. Water erodes rock and transports sediment by streams, rivers, ocean waves, and tides. And these processes can carve deltas, valleys, and canyons. An example of this is the Grand Canyon, which is water eroded and pretty freaking amazing. Wind predominantly affects dry and arid regions. And as wind blows, it picks up and carries loose particles. And these processes can shape landforms like sand dunes and rock arches. Glaciers carve rocks that they move over, and as they do so, they also pick up and carry material. This creates scour marks, U-shaped valleys, and moraines. Gravity can cause what's called mass wasting, in other words, landslides, debris flows, things like that. And this occurs when gravity pulls rocks downhill. And this is typically either triggered by steep slopes, earthquakes, and/or water saturation. So weathering and erosion often work hand in hand. Actually, pretty much always work hand in hand. Weathering weakens the rocks, making them susceptible to erosion. And erosion removes weathered material, exposing fresh rock for more weathering. So, finally, getting to our rock arch here, technically, like we talked about, things like wind and water can cause things like rock arches to form, but this process often involves both weathering and erosion. Because sometimes, if this is caused by wind erosion, then it's pretty much just the erosion that causes it. But if a rock arch forms by water erosion, then it may have also involved some dissolution, and that is considered weathering. So, weathering and erosion again work together. In any case, the next time you witness a magnificent mountain range or river valley or anything on our surface, remember that weathering and erosion work together to make that. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this video and enjoyed learning about weathering and erosion as much as I enjoy learning about these topics. As always, my references are linked down below, and if you want to check out related videos, I have the one on what is clay and kind of clay mineral formation that I'll link up here somewhere, because that talks more about feldspar dissolution and different clay phases that can form and soil and all of that. And if you want to learn more about silicate weathering, especially biologically facilitated silicate weathering, I talk more about that in my silicate weathering or microbial weathering video. I can't remember what I called it, but I'll link it up here. And with that, guys, thank you so much, and I can't wait to see you guys in the next one. Bye.